Hello, my name is Nicholl, and thank you so much for taking this time out to listen. Today, we are getting into the book Wolves in Shepherd's Clothing by Reverend Lamont Jones Jr. And he talks about the decline of the black church and the role of charlatans, counterfeits, and other scoundrels in the pulpit. He gives us a brief history about the black church, and he talks about the first African Baptist church in Savannah, Georgia in December 1777. And, of course, we are introduced to much of what the black church stood for centuries and centuries ago. But unfortunately, the Reverend says the black church has devolved rather than evolved. You see, the church was the home away from home for blacks, both slave and free, according to the Reverend. And black pastors rallied congregations and communities to press for justice and other noble causes. This tradition reached its apex in the 1950s and 60s. And that is on page 14 of Reverend Jones's book. But he says, not long after the legal, political, and social gains in the 60s, the black church began to wane in manifestation and exercise of supernatural power. Let me repeat that. Wane in manifestation and exercise of supernatural power. We are talking about things that even man and woman over these many, many centuries could not comprehend that was moving and shaking the black church. That trend has continued and in some estimations accelerated. This waning that the Reverend Jones is talking about. He says that one reason for this overall decline in church attendance in the U.S., a pattern not as pronounced among blacks as whites, but significant nonetheless, more than ever, there's competition for people's time, and there are options for exercising faith. And he says the privatization of religion also has had an impact. Many Christians today mistakenly believe that they can be as good a believer on their own apart from a congregation. And skipping down on the last sentence on page 14, many are turned off by local churches and religious denominations that claim to be the body and army of Christ, but look and feel more like pseudo communities that are superficial. So if you ever wonder why sometimes you go into churches and you feel the same way you went in as you did coming out, well, it's superficial, right? And that's not just in the black church. I've experienced that in non-denominational, predominantly white churches as well. The fake and the phony. On page 15, the black church is in a spiritual state of emergency because of a growing number of congregations where, what? Flesh rules and human will and ego reign. I talked with an individual not that long ago who said that there was a lot of rock music in this one particular church. And all the while he was going to this church, he said that he didn't really feel anything. He didn't feel anything different when he went there. If anything, he told me that he didn't want to work for God anymore. Now that's interesting because he was going to church even when he said it. There is something happening in the church, saints. And this was a predominantly white church. So yes, we're talking about the black church today, but this was a predominantly white church, where this black individual did not feel any move of the spirit. And since going, wasn't interested in working for God. It's sad, saints. It is sad to get to that place. But once again, the flesh is overriding the spirit. And in some of these audios, I talk about that. And I say that we've got to be about God's business, saints. I got to keep leading you back to Christ, even when you got problems in your relationship, even when you got problems at the workplace, even when you feel like God's not with you. I've got to take you back to Christ because that is what my job is. And that is what your job is. It's to take people back to Christ. Oh, but they don't want to hear it. Oh, you know, they get turned off. Oh, they lost their loved ones. Oh, they lost their job. But that has nothing to do with what our job is. Spreading the gospel. Reminding people what their place is. And sometimes you got to do it by taking your light and shining it in a dark place. That light that God has given you, that light that you accepted via Jesus Christ, via Holy Ghost. And that is what Reverend Lamont Jones Jr. is doing with this book. He is going to show us the archetypes. I've already read the book, but for some of you all, that's what you're going to get. You're going to get the archetypes of these leaders, okay, in the church. And you'll be able to not only discern those leaders in the church, but it will also help you when it comes to the workplace as well. You see, in the church, Reverend Jones says there's a lack of accountability at every level. Not all churches, but there are plenty. And he says, increasing numbers are reluctantly fleeing the black church in search of peace, and they are increasingly finding it at racially diverse churches under the leadership of white pastors. Didn't I just give you an example of an African-American who went to a predominantly white church, but he fled there only to find nothing? Okay? Now, there are some churches that I've gone to that were predominantly white and predominantly black, and I did feel the move of the Holy Ghost, and I know that I'd been changed. But there are many out there that folks are going every Sunday and they're not experiencing nothing. There are those that are so wrapped up in the Bible, which is great, but then they're wrapped up into the religious side of things as well. So they don't allow the Holy Ghost to move. So they have a problem when you start talking about what the Holy Ghost said, or the move of the Holy Ghost, or how you were led to do this, that, and the other based on what the Holy Ghost moved you to do. They have a problem with that because they have put God in a box. So here are some of these individuals who have fled these churches. They fled them not only because they saw some foolishness going on, or because the Holy Ghost wasn't moving or what have you, but they also fled them because they are just simply educated and spiritually more mature than the leadership. And Reverend Lamont Jones, he mentions that in his book. He said that these individuals are fed up with the naked narcissism, aggressive self-indulgence, self-important preening, and brazen duplicity that stretch from the pulpit to the front door on page 15. And then I jump down, but the reverend says there is a burning desire for authentic spiritual leadership that will selflessly lead them to the foot of the cross while courageously taking the battle to the enemy. That is what the people want. And if you are a leader and you're not giving them that, you're not taking them to the foot of the cross, you're not reminding them of Jesus Christ, and you're more concerned about getting your fleshly desires met, I'm telling you, you are headed for a downfall. Many of us have been in darkness for a long period of time because of stupid decisions that we made. We acted more like hypocrites than we were supposed to be acting like one true believers in Christ. And so some of us had to go through many fires as a result. On page 16, Reverend Lamont Jones talks about a research study that was published in 2012, which revealed that the highest percentage of U.S. Christians in the nation's history, 27%, reported that they are not affiliated with a specific church. And he says, in other words, one in every four self-proclaimed have, for whatever reasons, decided to disobey the biblical command to unite with other believers for corporate worship, spiritual maturation, fellowship, and evangelism. There are probably several reasons more people are choosing to be spiritually homeless, but the church must accept part of the responsibility for deciding to live below its calling by pledging allegiance to the shepherds who aren't truly committed to following the good shepherd. Once again, taking you back to Christ. On the same page, and it's the paragraph just before the last one, on page 16, the spiritual abuse of sheep at the hands of shepherds in the black church is seldom acknowledged and rarely addressed. Too many black church members will, like lemmings to the sea, follow a pastor over a cliff into a lake of fire to the gates of hell. Their collective behavior is pathological, and it is fueled by denial of the spirits of pettiness, envy, greed, lust, and control. And I will tell you that those that are very educated, They have some time on their hands. Those that love studying the black church, they will take what they have learned and use it against those believers. In mainstream media, in social groups, it shows up. Spirits of pettiness, envy, greed, lust, and control. Some of the non-blacks know blacks better than they know themselves. Lord Jesus. And so, according to Reverend Lamont Jones Jr.'s book, he says the problem is the growing number of wolves in shepherds' clothing. Wolves posing as shepherds do the work of the enemy, pawns in a plot, this is on page 17, forged in the pit of hell. Pastors who fully embody characteristics of archetypes described in the following chapters are beyond carnal. He said beyond carnal. There are men who pretend, some of you all are married to pretenders, some of you all attend church with pretenders, some of you all sit under leadership of pretenders. They are men who pretend to seek God's face, but rarely do, who routinely impose their own will, what I want, how I want it, right? And systematically plunder the flock while applying God's name to it. This is the work of the enemy, and as such, it's demonic. Demonic spirit of lust. Oh, forget what the scripture says. I'm just going to go after that woman in a pretty dress. Forget what the scripture says. I'm just going to go after the money. Forget what the scripture says. I'm just going to focus on building a name for myself. Lord Jesus, pride. Pride comes before fall, saints. And that is why so many, and I've said it in previous audio, that is why so many that we know, these big names out here, are going to fall hard. They think that they're sitting cushy, but their protection after a while is going to get tired of protecting them, and they're going to let them fall on their faces. These archetypes is what is in Reverend Lamont Jones Jr. book. And I'm sure that you could, play a matching game, if you will, with some of these folks in the mainstream media as well as in your backyard. In chapter 2, The Black Sheep in the New Millennium, he talks about the sheep, okay? They're compared to other common animals. Sheep may be the most vulnerable because they are relatively dumb and defenseless. And you see, if you're not educated, you're dumb. If you do not read and understand why you do what you do, why you're under the type of leadership that you're under, and things like that, then yes, you are in a place where you're going to be caught by the wolf. Defenseless. You're not wearing your spiritual armor of God. You see, the Christian might be characterized in a negative light, especially by Satanists when they talk about the sheep, and the sheep mentality and so forth. Okay. But the Christians are endowed with at least three things sheep do not have. And this is in Jones's book. An indwelling Holy Spirit, the full armor of Christ, and the capacity to make reasoned choices rather than rely on base instinct. Okay? That's what separates us. So all this foolishness about, name calling and we're sheep and sheeple and all this other foolishness. Know who you are in Christ, saint. Know who you are. All it was a metaphor. That's all it was in the Bible. It wasn't meant to be carried out in such a way where you're actually acting like a sheep. Lord Jesus. So on page 22, Reverend Jones talks about how this discussion, his book is essentially about black male pastors who take their places in pulpits and talk about God, but whose actions betray a disdain for God's principles and disrespect of God's people. And like I said before, it's not just the blacks, but there's also non-blacks as well that have a disdain for God's principles. Why? Because they can't live up to them. They're not trying to live up to them. It's too much work. It's too much work to get on one's knees and list all your sins and then repent. For some of them, that's how it is. Oh, what does God's word say again? And then if somebody holds you accountable, you got issue with that too. So some of those wolves in shepherd's clothing, they're just being rebellious. They're prideful. They're snakes in the grass. They're doing all sorts of foolishness because they don't want the light of God's word to shine on them. They will point the finger at everybody else in the congregation except at themselves. And some of them will point the finger at themselves, but all the while they'll keep doing what they're not supposed to be doing. So what's the sense in just bragging and boasting about, yeah, well, I'm just like you and I got my issues, but then you're still in it and you're not trying to be delivered. You don't want the saints to come up there and lay hands on you and cast out them demons of pride and lust and everything else. And I'm telling you that more and more churches need deliverance ministries. I've said it before and I'm saying it on this audio too, as I'm going through Reverend Jones's book. But we need some saints that are bold, that don't mind going up to the Christian or the non-believer and laying hands and saying in the name of Jesus. I mean, some folks, they may not believe in Christ, but they believe in the power of Christ. As strange as that might sound. And then once that power comes upon them, God willing, who knows what might take place. But give them a chance. Give the non-believer a chance. The unbeliever, give them a chance. No, we're going to sit in our little, you know, corner of the church in our favorite little seat and ignore those that came in or prejudge them because of the way they're dressed. Come on. And I've been in many churches where folks look at you with that funny look. Oh, I hope you're not here for long, because they know that you're coming in. Some of them can see that light. They know you're coming in and things are going to get stirred up in the atmosphere. I know for me, it's praise and worship. I come in and God uses me to remind the people of authentic praise, authentic worship in Him. And those that are unfamiliar with that, they'll say things like, I've never seen that sort of thing before. I'm boggled by that. Wow, that seems demonic. That's crazy. No, it's called praise and worship. Lord Jesus, but I don't want to get too far off base, because this book is a powerful book and you've got to take some time out and get books like this and learn about what is out there and quit walking ignorant. And on page 22, last paragraph, unchecked, wolves in shepherd's clothing are devouring sheep. You see, you're not holding them accountable. They're going to devour the sheep and scatter the flocks. Through deception and manipulation, according to Jones, these diabolical individuals turn some sheep into cannibals and reward their loyalty to the shepherd's twisted agenda. And it is twisted. Behind closed doors, if you were to sit in some of those meetings, you'd find out how twisted it is. Prideful. Name recognition, power, glorification of one's birthday and everything else associated with them. Jesus help us. Reading on, they participate in the destruction of the congregation, leaving Christian carcasses in their wake with a ripple effect that extends to homes and communities. So if I'm building myself up all the time with all sorts of things and I got the sheep doing the same thing, then when are we ever getting into the Bible? I mean, truly getting into it and applying the scripture to our lives. Jones goes on, their dastardly deeds serve the aims of the devil. In the midst of it all, most of the sheep are cooped, clueless, or too fearful to take a stand. Like any oppressed group, they rationalize and internalize their spiritual abuse and either ignore the problem or train their wrath on other sheep rather than on the wolves that so richly deserve it. Five archetypes of wolves in shepherd's clothing. Okay, let me get into those. The millionaire CEO. That's one Jones talks about. He talks about the control freak, COO. Okay. He gets into, and see, I have the book right in front of me, the sexual predator. I know you're hearing pages turning, but I like to read right from the book. He gets into the anti-traditionalist. And he's got some minor profiteers. He calls one the buffoon, He calls the other the entertainer and the other the Pharaoh. Now, we don't have a lot of time, so let's get through some of these archetypes. And then, I encourage you to get the book. The millionaire CEO, I think most of you all know who he is or she is and what she looks like. You've seen him or them on Preachers of LA and other reality shows. The millionaire CEO doesn't really have a heart for the community surrounding the church. The millionaire CEO grew up poor or looks back on his early life and feels he didn't have all of the material things he deserved. He chronologically grew up, but never psychologically grew out of a poverty of the mind that a country club membership can't erase. He is driven by an unspoken pledge to never be poor again, and he realizes his dream of prosperity, prosperity gospel, on the backs of church folk. He doesn't much care if people notice that he's all about the money and material trappings that he associates with success. He's happy to be living far better than he ever imagined, yet at the same time he lives with a secret fear of losing it all. He's spoiled, saints. He's spoiled, and he don't mind spoiling other folks by preaching all of his garbage about, ooh, sow some seeds, right? Sow some seeds into what? Are we really sowing seeds into the work of God, or are we sowing seeds into his very, very nice wardrobe? And that's the problem with some of these congregations. They don't question too much of anything. They don't even know how to elect a pastor. They don't know what the bylaws are. They don't know any of that. And Lamont talks about that in this book. Like other species of wolves in shepherd's clothing, the millionaire CEO has no interest in living in the community in which his church is located. Okay, page 29. Millionaire CEO shrewdly attempts to relocate the church farther out in the suburbs or some rural area. Okay, I've seen this with my own eyes. It's unfortunate, but that's what they do. Once they get so big and so this, that, and the other, or maybe they're struggling, but they just think a change of environment will do the trick. Reverend Jones says the millionaire CEO's pretense for moving is almost always more comfort and room for growth. Oh, he's got to preach to you about growing the church, getting more buildings and all that. Meanwhile, buildings just sit for years. Where's the money going? A lot of them will take the money and give it to this ministry, that ministry, and do this and that. But what about the building? What about the building that's still sitting there? Lord Jesus. Page 30. The bonus for numbers nonsense is a sleight of hand that casts an illusion of strength and vibrancy. Okay? It's a con used by some new pastors to pad their salaries and to make carnal members think the church is growing. Wow, did you catch that? Did you catch that? You see, they play games to blow up the numbers, saints, to make you think that the church is growing. Have you even taken the time out to look at how the marketing strategy plays out or how they're pulling these people in? And does it align with scripture? I'm just saying. And on page 31, the millionaire CEO is venturing into politics, right? A lot of them are doing it. For what reason? Selfish gain. Selfish gain to be out there, namesake, get some more money for the church. Build up those connections, right? That's what that crass careerist that Reverend Jones talks about does. Okay, the control freak COO. Let's get into him first. This control freak COO, he's got to be a part of everything, right? The control freak COO, according to page 34 of Reverend Jones's book, the control freak COO's lust is to gain and maintain tight control over the ministry and the congregation. He's got to know what's happening at all times. At all times. Now, this is a good thing, of course, you know, it is, to know what's going on. But the problem with this person is that he's got all these yes people around him. So yes, he might know about every little thing, but he's going to pick and choose what he wants done and how he wants to get it done. And you better agree. Bottom line. Reverend Jones says these walking and talking rubber stamps live for a lofty position in the congregation and secure by acquiescing to and helping to carry out the pastor's wishes and whims. They are co-enablers, their spirits of fear and insecurity feeding each other and infecting the congregation. The control freak COO is to surround himself with men he calls armor bearers, right? Nothing wrong with being an armor bearer, you know. But what's his problem? They have unswerving loyalty to the pastor, so they're not going to speak up. You could talk to the armor bearer and tell him, this is what's going on with the pastor. These are some things that's, you know, I don't like. And, you know, share some things that God even laid on your heart. And then the armor bearer is not going to do but so much, because he's a yes man or yes woman too. Okay. Typically, these well-intentioned bodyguards act as gophers, chauffeurs, and a wall between pastors and the people pastors don't have the time or inclination to be bothered with. You ever have an armor bearer stand in front of the pastor while you're trying to talk to him about something? And it could be just something simple about pray for me. It doesn't have to be anything critical. Oh, but no, here comes the armor bearer standing right in front. Oh, doesn't have time for questions. Oh, he has other things to do. Well, you know, right, excuses. There's no reason for that in a small church. I understand large church, but small church, get over yourself. The control freak COO has little interest in greeting members and guests before or after service. Okay, on page 35, the Reverend says the control freak COO in some cases is a bungler, right? He has a way of screwing up things and then covering up the error or blaming others, messing everything up. And then, we got to get the armor bearers to come help fix it up. We've got to get, you know, the assistants. We've got to get everybody around for a meeting because we got some stuff to figure out. After you done messed up everything, running your mouth or shaking hands with the devil. Lord Jesus, I'm talking to some folks out there, and some of you all know pastors like this, and you're signing up other folks for the madness. You need to stop, the Lord says. Stop it. Page 38. Many folks in the church, unfortunately, they don't know how a pastor is selected. Did you ever bother to ask about that? Did anybody answer your question or give you anything in writing? Shady dealings. The Reverend talks about spiritually mature believers recognize the value of a significant period of communal fasting and prayer as they seek to discern the choice of God. You need to know whether or not you need to attend a certain church. You need to know whether or not you should stay in a particular church. Are you fasting? Are you praying? Are your eyes wide open for the things that you like as well as the things that you don't? Are you one of them that every time somebody brings something to your attention about the pastor or the assistants or what have you that's negative, you're ready to defend them? Lord Jesus. No, you need to seek the Lord, saint. Seek the Lord. Too many people are being led to the slaughter by the wolf in shepherd's clothing. Matter of fact, the Reverend Jones, he refers to a site on the internet where these folks are fit to be tied, and they have a long list of things they're tired of when it comes to the church. And they title it, We Are Tired. Welcome to our church folk revolution, where we will begin the process of taking back our churches from corrupt, elitist, manipulating, greedy, sex-addicted pastors. This site was created to simply let the church leaders know that we, as the body of Christ, is tired of being exploited for their personal gain. And I'm sure that if you do a little research, you'll find out that website. I'm not going to share that website. I happen to stumble across it myself, and even in the Reverend's book, he doesn't give you the website page, but you can look up the Church Folk Revolution. Okay. All right. Now, the sexual predator, he is somebody that you do not want to mess around with. You know, when you know that the lust spirit is all over him and he's been flirting with you or she's been flirting with you. Why is it that you still want to, you know, keep this person in leadership? I do not know. And I've seen so many of that foolishness going on. Now, the Reverend says this archetype may be the most devastating because of the havoc he wrecks physically, emotionally, psychologically, and spiritually. He regards his serial fornication or adultery with temple prostitutes and women outside the congregation as a perk of the position. Or this wolf may be of a species that targets young men or boys to satisfy his perverse appetite for domination. And you know what many of these loyalists to this type of individual will do? They will defend him. They will say God knows, and God will pray him through. But if you got a pornography addiction, or you have a wandering eye, or you can't stay true to your wife, or whatever the case may be, or you got a little fetish for little boys or little girls, why are you in a congregation like that? I will tell you that for some people that are like that, they are doing those things while they're sitting there in the church now. Now, I'm not saying literally, you know, I mean, because they know how to hide it. They know how to hide it. But they're doing these things and justifying it, finding reasons to keep doing it. On page 46, the perpetrator agrees with the enemy's lie that pedophilia or adultery or fornication is not wrong. But he knows it's wrong. But what did I tell you? He tries to hide it. Right there in his book. He tries to hide it. And what he doesn't get into, but I will, there are so many that are involved with various secret societies and fraternal groups and so forth that practice all sorts of rituals that involve sexual perverse behavior. And so once you allow that spirit to come in, it is hard to shake it off. If it's hard for a man or a woman to shake off sexual pornography, having been exposed to it as a child, you know it's real hard to shake off a man or woman who has participated, or a demonic spirit that has attached itself to that man or woman through some type of ritual. And these people walk around and they will smile while their eyes are looking you up and down. These people will say things that are inappropriate. They are very, very charming. They will flatter you. They will claim friendship. And next thing you know, they're finding a way to put you on your back. I praise God that I have not experienced leadership like this, but I have experienced so-called Christian men that have acted in these ways. And 9 times out of 10, who knows? They're mentors. They probably picked up some foolishness from them. And unfortunately, I would have to say that there are some young men and young women who have been turned out by these leaders. And when I say turned out, I mean they have been abused by these leaders, all in the name of so-called favor or God or whatever they want to put their spin on it, just so that they can keep getting away with nasty behavior. And God sees all. And I'm going to leave that one alone. Reverend Jones talks about the anti-traditionalist archetype in chapter 6 of his book. And this traditionalist, he wants to just do everything different. He wants to do what he wants to do when he wants to do it. He's not interested in what God says, what the Bible says, what the church history is like. And unfortunately, he also messes up things, and he's unfit to lead, and he gets other people to fix his mistakes. Reverend Jones says that a subspecies of the anti-traditionalist is the bungler. He's unfit to lead a congregation primarily due to a lack of wisdom. He epitomizes ineptitude and incompetence, wrecking churches and then laying the blame on others before moving on to the next victim. Nothing is too small for him to mess up. No fire too small for him to start. The crass careerist. I've been waiting to get to this one. Some of you all, you know him. He is about building up his career. His type of networking is unhealthy. And according to Jones's book, it's obsessive or self-serving. He's relentless. He's a ruthless networker. He sees ministry as an occupation rather than a calling. He has bought into the deception that his human connections and hookups are the key to a prosperous ministry, prosperity defined as whatever is more and bigger. Rather than trusting primarily in God for opportunities, choices, and guidance, he relies on worldly strategies taught at secular universities and increasingly at theological schools. And that was on page 54. On page 55, according to Jones, he says a recent trend that suggests crass careerism is the rise in the number of black pastors joining what Greek letter social fraternities. Even in the graduate chapters that permit pledging and initiation decades after leaving college, the perceived benefits are obvious. Access to more potential church members or financial supporters, more opportunities to gain speaking engagements and accompanying income, advantage in acquiring desired real estate, a government grant, appointments to influential boards and commissions. Choosing to frat up at a time in life when he should be spiritually mature enough to know better probably reveals a hunger for more power, more influence, more money. And they don't mind showing up with those colors. And they don't mind. They don't mind advertising their affiliations on bumper stickers, on key rings, on pins, on their lapel. They don't mind. And you know, and I know, if you are a mature believer, that anytime you get into the Greek mysticism and mythology and all of that stuff associated with idols and idol worshiping, you are in for some trouble. Enjoy the purse now, but you're going to pay later. Through health, wealth, something's going to go down. Children, relatives, mysterious circumstances, unanticipated, unexpected deaths. Because somebody opened up their mouth and said the wrong thing. Oh, Lord Jesus. Things happen. Messing around with them fraternal groups. According to Jones, he says, pastors need to maintain an independence that allows them to challenge institutions on behalf of the oppressed, marginalized, and disenfranchised. Going on, while black pastors increasingly join private clubs and secret societies, the black pulpit's prophetic voice has become what? Silent. When righteous indignation is needed to call corporations and politicians to account for racist practices, the careerists and others are mute. Oh, no, we can't speak on that. Oh, my career, my career. Self-interest leads them to shut up rather than stand up and speak up. You're not going to get me to say anything. You're not going to get me to do anything. But what about God? What about this? What about that? You can quote scripture all day long. You see, that's how they are. Lord Jesus, the career minded, the career focused, always my career. All right. The Minor Profiteers in chapter 8, page 57. And I'm just going to give you some titles and a little brief on what Mr. Jones has mentioned here. The buffoon, he's characterized by a spirit of foolishness and social ineptitude. You know, he's going to joke around. Everything is silly in his eyes. You know that. Some of you all come across these ones that want to use the pulpit more, you know, for their stand-up than anything else. He specializes in talking out of turn, displaying a penchant for saying and doing the most inappropriate things at the most inappropriate times. The entertainer, he's the fraternal twin of the buffoon. He charms as he disarms. He's a charismatic personality, and ability to perform are his weapons, and his craving for attention is fed by the applause and approval of the people. Rather than mastering the art of a tasteful and well-timed pun in the pulpit, he jokes relentlessly to an annoying degree, diminishing the office of the pastor. Excuse me for that. The silly man is more of the entertainer that I mentioned earlier, you know, the joker. The buffoon, though, he's leading that effort within the church, the one to dumb down society. Okay, that's what he's about. He's going to take everything that you should be critically thinking about, because I've come across them myself, and he's going to find a way to, you know, trivialize it. It's not that important. It's no big deal. When yes, it is important. Okay, so please forgive me for that. So the Pharaoh, a subspecies of the control freak COO, the Pharaoh has a hard heart into the warnings of God and the cries of the sheep. He's not listening. You're coming to him, you're telling him things, he's not listening to you. According to Jones's book, from his throne on the pulpit, he pretends to not see how God wants to move in the midst of the congregation. The Holy Spirit is tugging on him. Maybe we should stay in praise and worship a little while longer. He's looking at the clock. He sees it, but he chooses to ignore it, or he fights it. Everything is either his way or the highway. He enlists his appointed jesters and magicians to confuse and distract the people. But everybody isn't hoodwinked. Oh, Lord Jesus. Get the book, saints. Get the book. I gave you enough information, but you need more. Get the book, saints. There's a prayer that you definitely want to read if you have been caught up in some of this foolishness. And there's also 16 recommendations for shepherds. Okay, those of you all who are leading the flock, some things you might want to consider. And Reverend Jones also gives you some tips for sheep, 6 recommendations for the sheep. Okay, to protect yourself. So this is not a book that you want to take lightly. If you want more from Reverend Lamont Jones Jr., he has a number of seminars and trainings, some of which is the Watchful Warriors on the Wall, the Necessity and Vitality of Intercessory Prayer Ministries, the Power of One, the Labor and Fruit of Congregational Unity, When the Battle is Yours, the Everyday Reality of Spiritual Warfare and How to Fight, and he has a number of others. For more information, you are encouraged to contact the author at LamontJonesJr@gmail.com. This, I know, was a lengthy audio, but for those of you all who are about making the right decision when it comes to leadership, you needed this. And I hope you got a lot out of it. Please do get Wolves in Shepherd's Clothing, The Decline of the Black Church and the Role of Charlatans, Counterfeits and Other Scoundrels in the Pulpit by Reverend Lamont Jones Jr. Thank you for listening. And as always, to God be the glory.